Dr. K.N. Srinivasan to deliver his talk on hypertension treatment and overview.
Take the mic closer to you.
Thanks for the opportunity given to me. I'm going to talk about the common topic hypertension in the next 10 to 15 minutes. We'll just see the old molecule, diuretics, how it does the wonders. Today, hypertension is increasing. There is a global rise.
Yeah, that's the problem.
And India, both increases in population and of course it's up for lifestyle diseases. Next to diabetes, hypertension is coming now. And hypertension is a multifactorial disease and the age limit is coming down. What we thought hypertension is an elderly disease, today we can see hypertension occurs in younger age group also. And the importance is when the hypertension occurs in younger age group, the duration of hypertension increases because the survival is increasing. So the target or the damage also is increasing. And most of the cases, what we see, we start the treatment, but the control is not good. There is poor control, and that gets into the target organ damage. Most of the cases are still undiagnosed. So in this slide, you can see from 2000 to 2025, you can see there will be a steep increase in the prevalence. In developing countries, it increases by 80%, and developed countries by 20%. And what is happening? There is a very good statement, a very dangerous statement actually. If you see. From Framingham Heart Study, individuals who are non-hypertensive at 55 years of age have a 90% lifetime risk for developing hypertension. If you see this statement, suppose 90 out of 100 is going to have high BP one day or other in their lifetime. And what is in India? India, it's the same. There is rising hypertension in urban as well as in rural setting. There is data from Rajiv Gupta et al. And in 1994, what it was 30%. 2003 does not 50%. So there is a prevalence has increased by about 30 times among urban residents and about 10 times among rural residents. And lifespan is prolonged, so hypertension affects a large part of the age range. And this is in Kerala, what is happening? In urban, 30%, in slum, it is 25.9%. So it's a disease irrespective of the socioeconomic status. And this is the data from Jaipur Heart Watch Study. And here also you can see both sexes, men and women, the hypertension is steeply increasing. In 2004 to 2005, as high as 45% in men and as high as 38% in women. So irrespective of the sex, as the age advances, the chances of risk of hypertension is increasing. And what is very prominent here is, as age advances, you can see that the systolic hypertension is increasing. The isolated systolic hypertension is more common in elderly, and the diastolic blood pressure being high is coming down as age advances. That's very clearly demonstrated in this slide. And the second thing is rise in young hypertensives. The prevalence of hypertension in the younger age group between 30 and 39 was 13.7% in India. And these, what is important is these young hypertensives are at greater risk for organ damage due to their longer duration of hypertension. What are the target organ damage? Starting from brain, they can have stroke, irreversible hemorrhage or hypertensive encephalopathy, and in the eyes they can have hypertensive retinopathy and loss of vision, and in the heart they can have hypertensive heart disease, they can have coronary artery disease, congestive heart failure, and in the kidneys they can have renal disease, and in the peripheral vascular system they can have peripheral vascular disease. So in the heart, blood pressure and risk of coronary artery disease, if you see, as the age advances, the systolic blood pressure is more directly related to the coronary risk. So you can see in the age group 65 to 94, the systolic blood pressure, when it goes up, there is a steep increase in the coronary artery disease as against the younger age group. But in the younger age group, the diastolic blood pressure is more important. It is well documented in this slide. Not only the control of blood pressure, it is the control for 24 hours. So throughout the 24 hours, the blood pressure should be under control, for the simple reason that excessive morning surge in blood pressure in hypertensive patients has been shown to have excessive incidence of strokes, heart failure, coronary artery disease. You can see early morning, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, people land up with acute myocardial infarction, acute stroke. The reason is because of the excessive morning surge in the blood pressure. So we have to have a molecule, an antihypertensive, that has a 24 hours action that will have a better outcome when we choose these molecules. So why should we treat? What is the impact of the BP reduction? Each increment of 20 millimeters of mercury in systolic blood pressure or 10 millimeters of mercury in diastolic blood pressure doubles the risk of cardiovascular disease. This is a statement from the ACE7. In India, hypertension is directly responsible for 57% of all stroke deaths and 24% of all coronary heart disease deaths. You can see in this slide, it is a population study. In a population, if you reduce 2 millimeters of mercury of decrease in BP, can prevent 151,000 stroke and 157,000 coronary disease deaths. So this is another slide which shows by reducing the BP, we can reduce the mortality because of ischemic heart disease and the mortality because of stroke in various age groups, starting from 40 to 49. You can see here 40 to 49, then 50 to 59. When the blood pressure comes down, you can see the deaths comes down. But what is very pathetic is even in US, this slide shows even in US, the awareness of hypertension is increases year by year. See, from 76 to 80, it was about 51%. Then in 2007-2000, the awareness is about 81%. But what is pathetic is how much of them are getting controlled. It is only 50% of the people who are on treatment got the BP under control or to the optimal level. And the same in Chinese study, here also you can see the awareness is 42%, but the control is only 3.7%, which makes us important that it is not the diagnosis or the starting of treatment, it is the importance is to control the blood pressure to the optimum level. And this is in India, and Kerala, you can see the awareness varies as between 38%, in urban to slum 36. But what is here also the same set of story, the control is only 9%. And even there is another important point that urban people, slum people, both control is 9%. Says that you have money in urban people, most of them have affiliated people have money, but despite that, still no, the control is only 9%, saying that it is the patient education and frequent checkups, and we have to adjust the medications. It's optimum to have a better control of blood pressure. And this is just a classification before going into the proper JNC7 classification, what is normal blood pressure, what do you mean by pre-hypertension between 120 to 150 of systolic, 80 to 89 of diastolic, and stage 1 hypertension is 140 to 159, diastolic of 90 to 99, and stage 2 hypertension is anything equal or more than 160 of systolic, and anything equal or more of 100 of diastolic is stage 2 hypertension. We have in our armamentarium ABCD, AC inhibitors, angiotensin receptor blockers, beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and diuretics. So we will focus on diuretics this time. Diuretics started as early as 1948. We had injections of mercurial diuretic as an antihypertensive. And then in 1957, we got the chlorothiazide tablets. I mean, from parenteral, we get tablets. Large doses of diuretics initially started. So it went out of the market because of a lot of side effects. Then the concept of lower doses equally effective with the less side effects came in 70s to 80s, and 90s we got the largest trial, ALA trial, which gives a lot of guidelines for the antihypertensive treatment. So 60s we had 200 to 600 milligram of fluoxetine was used, very large doses. Then in 70s and 80s we thought small doses is sufficient and less side effects. So 80s we had the multiple risk factor intervention trial and systolic hypertension injury program. In 90s we got the ALA trial, that is anti-lipid therapy and antihypertensive therapy in reducing the heart attack trial. 2008-2009 we know that even a 6.25 milligram of fluoxetine can be used as antihypertensive. And this is a slide from JNCS 1977 to JNCS 7 2003. Diuretic is there almost in all the recommendation, and what they recommended is thiazide type diuretic. Then last in JNCS 7 they said thiazide type diuretic either alone or in combination can be used. So it is the thiazide type diuretic or the thiazide diuretic. So that's the difference, thiazide-like diuretic or thiazide-type diuretic. We have thiazide-type diuretic, we have the clothiazide, and thiazide diuretic, we have the thiazide. The thiazide-like diuretics are important in that both it can be used alone or it can be used as a combination with other molecules, because we know that any patient who has more than 20 millimeters of systole height, more than 10 diastole height, falls into stage 2 hypertension, and he will need a combination therapy. What is the international experience with this clothiazide molecule? We have the systolic hypertension elderly program. This is a trial which is a good number of people, about 2,700 patients, followed up for 4.5 years, and the BP reduction was 12 millimeters in the systole, and it was predominantly a systolic hypertension patients were included, and they are followed up. Here you can see, even in placebo there was a reduction in blood pressure, not only in the active treatment, but of course the active treatment who were on clothiazide, the reduction was quite significant. And they found that 30 strokes were reduced for 1,000 people who have been treated with clothiazide, saying that reduction of blood pressure in elderly group with isolated systolic hypertension is very important to reduce the stroke. And this study was followed up for 14 years and found that the incidence of stroke significantly reduced with clothiazide. And this is the another trial, ALA trial, antihypertensive lipid lowering treatment for heart attack trial. And here it's huge number of population, 42,400 odd patients got included, divided into four groups, one with clothiazide, another on amlodipine, lisinopril and doxycycline. Doxycycline of course withdrawn because of lack of any efficacy, and these other three groups were compared, and they followed the patients first month, 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, then every 4 months for 8 years, and that's the result. Both the systolic and diastolic pressures were reduced, but when you compare with the three molecules at the year 5, we see with clothiazide, that's the yellow, green is with lisinopril, the yellow is with amlodipine, and the other one is with clothiazide. And the clothiazide one is 4 to 7% better control of blood pressure than the other two. And this is with stroke and this is with heart failure. So when they compared with amlodipine, the clothiazide group had 38% less risk of heart failure compared to amlodipine. And when they compare with the lisinopril, the clothiazide group had 15% lesser risk of stroke, 19% less risk of heart failure. So the conclusion says that better control of systolic blood pressure achieved with clothiazide than with amlodipine or lisinopril. Note the point, better control of systolic blood pressure, so good for elderly group. Similar reduction of risk for CHD death or non-fatal MI. So clothiazide was associated with lower risk for stroke, heart failure comparing with lisinopril, and lower risk of heart failure compared with amlodipine. What about in clinical practice? Stage 1 hypertension, you can choose clothiazide as a single drug, start with 6.25 mg once daily, then you can gradually go up to 25 mg per day. The common side effects are rash and dizziness, course, we have to keep in mind hypokalemia, dyslipidemia, hyperglycemia, and hyperglycemia. This slide shows the compelling indications for diuretics. Diabetes, high coronary artery disease, heart failure, recurrent stroke prevention, these are all the four compelling indications where diuretic is indicated as per the recommendation of the GHSR. And clothalidone in elderly, because elderly people have isolated systolic effects more commonly, and clothalidone is a very good drug there, and it's well tolerated also, and it increases the calcium level, so it's a possible prevention of bone fractures. And clothalidone is here also, it's another slide where you can see as the age advances, the isolated systolic effects goes up. So clothalidone is both safe and effective for stage 1 isolated systolic hypertension. What about in diabetic patients? Can we use this molecule? The systolic hypertension elderly program trial has shown clearly that clothalidone low yet represents both the groups with fewer adverse effects. But what is important is absolute risk reduction with clothalidone was twice as great for diabetic versus non-diabetic patients. So it is the control of blood pressure irrespective of the molecule that is more important rather than the molecule as such. And this is metabolic syndrome. What about metabolic syndrome? Alert findings. That assume clothalidone is equal to amlodipine, equal to lisinopril as far as metabolic syndrome patients with hypertension are considered. Clothalidone is insulin therapy for hypertension offers similar and in some instances possibly superior outcomes in elderly hypertensive patients with metabolic syndrome. So these are some of the experts' opinion. Norman Kaplan has told millions of hypertensive patients have been given a less effective drug, that is hydrochlorothiazide, that almost certainly didn't protect them as well as CTD would have. And another expert, Michael Ernest, he has told our findings on left ventricular hypertrophy support, the idea that greater blood pressure reduction with clothalidone than with the hydrochlorothiazide may have led to differences in mortality observed in multiple respective intervention trials. And yet another statement, hydrochlorothiazide is inappropriate first line therapy in hypertension. If your thiazide type diuretic is indicated, it should be clothalidone. And you can see here, the clothalidone is about 1.5 to 2 times as potent as hydrochlorothiazide. A clothalidone of 6.25 is equal to 12 of hydrochlorothiazide. So clothalidone, how it is superior to hydrochlorothiazide? Do we have any data? The data comes here. The clothalidone 25 mg will reduce the 12.4 mm mercury BP reduction, as against 50 mg hydrochlorothiazide, which will reduce only by 7.4 mmHg. And what about nighttime control of BP? It is still better with clothalidone because clothalidone has a half life of about 60 hours. So it starts with 2 to 3 hours and the effect lasts as 2 to 3 days, the effect is there. So that gives the additional protection from early morning surge and thereby preventing stroke and myocardial infarction. This is the statement which we saw earlier. In multiple respective intervention trial, hydrochlorothiazide group had a 44% higher mortality. But those patients received to clothalidone, later with clothalidone the trend was reversed and the same group had a 28% lower risk. What about safety with clothalidone? We are afraid about diuretics because it can cause hypokalemia, it can cause dyslipidemia, hyperglycemia, hyperglycemia. Here the data comes, when you use low doses of diuretics, clothalidone baseline is sodium is 138, but at the end it is 138. But see the potassium 4.2 came to 3.9, very negligible change in the potassium level. This is, you can see at the end of 4 years, it slowly comes to the baseline. The hypokalemia was not severe and returns to the baseline after 4 years of treatment. What about lipid profile? Long-term studies have failed to show adverse effects on lipid concentration even though the smaller trials, short-term trials have shown, but smaller doses generally doesn't alter the lipid profile. This is the data from ALART trial. You can see the baseline lipid is 260. At the end of 4 years, it comes to 197 total cholesterol. And this is another thing from the systolic hypertension program trial. The diabetes, hyperglycemia with clothalidone. New cases by 1 year, 3.6% as against 2.9% with placebo. And new cases by 3 years, 8.6 as against 7.5, but the p-value is not very significant. And this is Indian trial from Parekh et al. We have shown that the fasting blood sugar has slightly gone up about 4 milligrams, but PPBS is rather it has come down with this molecule. saying that, you know, slight change, not say significant change, negligible effect, you can call it. So lower doses do not have much change in the glucose level, number one. In ALART, there was no effect of change in the fasting glucose on cardiovascular deaths and renal outcomes. And in systolic hypertension program trial, diabetes mellitus that developed during the diuretic therapy, so no significant increase in the cardiovascular mortality as compared to diabetes mellitus that developed in the absence of diuretic. So those who have not received this molecule and that they developed diabetes, and they compared with those who received the molecule, there was no significant difference as far as the cardiovascular disease mortality is concerned. And what is the latest data says? It has a lot of pleiotropic effects. It inhibits the platelet aggregation, it promotes the angiogenesis, it reduces the vascular permeability, thus benefits in the congestive heart failure. So chlorthalidone has some unique properties not shared by the thiazides, per se, like this pleomorphic properties. It is the most voluntary at reducing cardiovascular morbidity independent of its peak reducing ability. It is chemically different from the so-called hydrochlorothiazide. So the recommendation, the guideline says that JNC7 recommends a much greater importance to the use of thiazide-type diuretic as the preferred first-line therapy than it was being in the past. The recommendation says that whenever BP is more than 20 systolic, 10 diastolic above the goal BP, use of two classes of drugs should be considered, and one of these should be a thiazide-type diuretic. And World Health Organization International Society of Hypertension says, for the majority of patients without a compelling indication for another class of drug, like heart failure, diabetes, so if there is no any compelling indication, in low-dose diuretic should be considered as the first choice of therapy. So, to end, chlorthalidone has a dual action. What it does is blood pressure reduction and peripheral vascular resistance reduction. The immediate blood pressure reduction because of the blood volume reduction, diuresis. But on long term, say after 8 weeks of treatment, the blood volume reduction goes off. It is the peripheral vascular resistance reduction that keeps the blood pressure lowering effect. And better goal BP achievement you can achieve. Good nighttime BP control because of the long half-life. Superior target organ protection because of the good control of BP. And suited for isolated systolic hypertension. And JNC7 recognition of this molecule. And safe in low doses, as low as 6.25 milligrams is very effective. So let's have less habit and more reason. That is, in other words, you know, as a habit, we tend to write hydrochlorothiazide. So let's have less habit and more reason and start using this chlorthalidone for hydrochlorothiazide. Thank you.
Floor is open for discussions.
The younger members of the audience may not be aware that this molecule was the first drug used in 1960s. Hydroxychloroquine. Then chlorthalidone alone, chlorthalidone with reserve. Same way, the other drugs also was extensively used as drugs. These two drugs have been excessive. I have some questions before that I will make an observation. When I was preparing a lecture on drug death over the sands of time, how the drugs appeared and how the drug died, one pharma chief told me, include also government taxation in drug death. When the government puts control, the pharma companies withdraw it. Therefore, there should be one other thing you should introduce on the drug death. I think chlorthalidone had a death because it was not a profitable. Now come to scientific discussion. Dr. Srinivasan, is there any basic physiological difference on the kidney in the action of these two drugs? Is there any very basic physiological difference on the kidney?
Chlorthalidone acts on the level of distributed blocks the absorption of the chloride. So that by the chloride and sodium goes in the urine and it produces the early effect of the antibiotic therapy. That is between 2 to 8 weeks of starting this molecule. So what happens is after that, the body compensates. So the effect slowly, you know, this so-called diuretic effect goes off. And how it produces antibiotics because of peripheral vascular resistance. They have given some postulations or possible mechanisms. One, they say that it reduces the calcium release from the cells induced by the norepinephrine. It prevents the so-called Rho kinase activity. It reduces the vascular edema and it causes decrease in the vascular permeability. This is one of the possible mechanism by which it reduces the peripheral vascular resistance, which is not seen with hydrochlorothiazide. In that way, you know, it, the effect of this molecule is seen over the long term use.
Means your observation, Sachinji, is basically there's not much difference in the nephron action of these two molecules. Whereas the adenosine benefits on the other sides of it. Now, if you have got a combination of thiazide and some of the vasodilators or volume reducing drugs, will it not be equal to using this molecule?
Very good. The thing is, you know, when we use the other molecule, I mean, this molecule, if you want to use for those effects, then you have to use large doses. Then obviously the side effects become small. That's why the combination of small dose with another good vasodilator like ACE inhibitor or in ARBs like losartan with hydrochlorothiazide becomes a very handy. So less side effects, you'll have a better outcome.
That means the recommendation by all the group of people that going for yearly two drugs in a low combination still stands.
Yeah.
Whether one is clotheridone or one is clothrate. Now, another question you ask yourself. How far is the reliable of all these studies which only target the clinical outcome without attending to the basic physiological effect of the drugs? I repeat the question. All these drugs, you say that mortality, you set some deadlines, fellow dying or fellow having a magnetic function or fellow having a developing diabetes mellitus, and then say this group develops it, this group does not develop. When there is no basic difference in the physiological action of these molecules, for example, I will give you an example of ACE inhibitors or ARBs, basically they are not much different. But still, to promote one molecule as more because of some p-values higher at the end result, is it justified in the trial?
No, actually, whatever trial which I showed, it is basically chlorothalidone molecule as per se has efficacies. Both in systolic hypertension LV program as well as in the other trial said that chlorothalidone is definitely an efficacious molecule. But coming to the point, chlorothalidone versus hydrochlorothiazide, chlorothalidone is more potent. Longer duration, in small doses, it is effective compared to hydrochlorothiazide. In that way, it becomes better compared to hydrochlorothiazide.
No, I am not answering your question. How far the trials that target only certain outcomes, right, without basic attention to the physiological mode of action? Because these are essentially very different physiological mode of action, except that some research and findings have given us some new modes of action.
No, that is correct. What I am trying to say is, in this particular molecule, whatever discussion which we had, the trials, there is, all these trials, they have not compared the chlorothalidone versus thiazide. What they have done is chlorothalidone versus amlodipine, chlorothalidone versus lisinopril, ACE inhibitor versus calcium channel blocker versus alpha blocker, that is doxazosin. Of course, doxazosin doesn't have any effect, so they left it. So what they found out when they took the systolic blood pressure as a reading, the diuretic chlorothalidone reduced 2 millimeters mercury extra compared to amlodipine. 1 millimeter mercury extra comparing to lisinopril, which was statistically significant. But when they compare the diastolic blood pressure, the amlodipine became superior. Amlodipine reduced 1 millimeter mercury extra comparing to the diuretic as well as the lisinopril. So that, even though it, in values it is so small, but it becomes statistically significant. That's what the trial says.